So now we'll go for the picture number 6. And if you remember, we have seen this example. Just go through it again, once again. There may be some change in number. I'm in a workshop, so there may be some noise around me. The work is going on. See, this is somebody is coming. I think I should let him in. Several times I told you, people are asking you to join with VPK BIT domain email ID. I don't know why don't you understand it. It's very simple. You just need to click the link and join with your VPK BIT email ID. It's very simple. Still, people are not able to understand technology, and you are using Instagram, Facebook, WhatsApp. Okay, of anthracite coal per day, it is a coal consumption per day. Okay, and a calorific value of coal is 20,000 kilojoule. Okay, calorific value is 20,000 per joule. Now I think I should not allow. Okay, so calorific value of coal is 20,000 kilojoule per kg. Okay, if the power generation in one day is 9 megawatt, find overall efficiency of power plant. Okay, that is the example now here. So let's start with the given things, okay, and what you need to find. So overall efficiency of power plant. So only a little change in the value here. Yesterday I gave something else here, and now I modified it to 20,000 kilojoule per kg. It's a calorific value of that particular coal, because it's anthracite coal that we are burning for the thermal power plant. And it has a maximum calorific value is up to 24,000 kilojoule per kg. Okay, that is a calorific value. With that, we need to find what is the input power available. Then, you know, the power generation is the output power by the thermal power plant, that is 9 megawatt. Okay, and find the overall efficiency. So overall efficiency is always output divided by input. So can you do it quickly here? Okay, so I pasted this numerical for you in the Word file. Okay, so now you see 100 tons of anthracite coal per day. Okay, so let me take an Excel file here. Okay, now I can tell you what is the given data. Okay, given data, have you written it numerical? Just concentrate on the given data. What is given data here is 100 ton. Okay, 100 ton of say given is what we have is mass of the fuel that is equal to 100 ton. Okay, mass of fuel is 100 ton. What else is given? This is calorific value, CV. CV is equal to 20,000. Okay, I'll do it like this. Mass of the fuel is 100 ton. Then CV that you have is 20,000. Okay, and say output is equal to what is output?
Generated.
Yes, 9 megawatt means in terms of kilowatt you can do. 9 megawatt means 9 into what is
10^6.
Yes, it is 9 into 10^6. Okay, so better way I'll do here. 9 into 10^6 means it's watt only. 9 into 10^6 is watt. So I'll do 9 into 10^6. It is 9 into 10 raised to 3 kilowatt. Okay, that is the value. And what will be it? 9 into 1000. 9 into 1000 is the kilowatt. So 9000 kilowatt is the output. Now what you need to find is the input. How do you find the input? Input is equal to. Input is equal to. What do you have the formula for input? How much coal that you are burning per day, and based on that you need to multiply with the calorific value. Okay, so kg per second that you need to get as a mass. Mass is in tons. Okay, 100 tons. So you need to convert this mass into kg per. Okay, this is a mass in 100 tons. Okay, 100 tons. 100 tons. Okay, and now this you need to convert into kg per second. How do you convert it? 100 tons means 100 into 1000. So you get 100,000 kg. Okay, 1 ton is equal to 1000 kg. And what you need to do? This mass you need to convert as a per day. So it is in per day, but you have to convert it into per second. So this is divided by 24 hours into 60 minutes into 60 seconds. Understood? Are you getting this, all of you? 100 ton is the mass. You convert that into kg, so 100,000 kg. That is for per day. So we are dividing that value with the second. Okay, so 24 hours into 60 minutes into 60 seconds. This is the value that you get. What is it? It is kg per second. Okay, kg per second. This mass you get now. This mass is in kg per second. 1.157 kg per second. This is the mass. And what is the input value that you have? Input value, input power. How do you find input power? Any guess? Input power available in the thermal power plant. Yes? Yes?
Mass
la kasa convert? What you are saying?
Mass consumption.
Yeah.
Tons madna kg per second madhe kasa kela?
Ha, once again, if you see here, can you see here on top this one? Here if you see this black color I'm showing you here on the top, is it visible?
Yes.
So actually what is there, 100 ton is the mass that you are burning per day. You need to understand problem. It is very easy, but don't leave. Understand it. 100 ton, 1 ton is 1000 kg. Okay, 1 ton is 1000 kg. So you need to convert it into kg. So 100,000 kg. So that's why what I did here, 100 into 1000 that we have done here. Check now. 100 into 1000 kg. Then per day means what? We need to convert it into per second. So instead of per day, I divide it with the 24 hours. Then it will be converted into per hour. Then I divide it into divide again by 60 minutes. Then it will be per minute. Then I divide it into again with the 60 seconds. Then it will be converted into per second. So instead of that, what I did combinedly, 24 hours into 60 minutes and into 60 seconds. These are the number of seconds for a day. 24 into 60 minutes into 60 seconds. These are the number of seconds per day. So you just divide this with the total kg. Total kg is what? 100,000 kg. 100,000. 100 ton means what? 100 into 1000. That is the kg. Okay. So that much you are dividing with this seconds, number of seconds, and what you get is the 1.157 kg per second. Are you getting it? This one?
Yes.
So this kg per second is the mass consumption, mass flow rate. Okay. In the boiler, in the furnace, that much coal you are burning per second. Okay, 1.157 kg per second that you are burning in the furnace. Now, how do you find the input energy? How do you find the input energy?
Sir, we have a formula of calorific value now. Heat addition by kilojoule by kilogram of fuel.
Yes. So, how what to do? What to do? I mean, what is the next mathematical operation?
Next, so mathematical. We will find heat addition, and heat addition is also in joule. No?
Yes. So, heat addition is in joule. But what is expected here? How do you calculate the input? Logic is correct, but how do you calculate?
Mass into calorific value.
Correct. Mass into calorific value. Why? Okay, why? Because see here, you get unit of mass in kg per second. If you check here,
I'm showing you
in the Excel. You can enlarge. Okay, you can enlarge your screen in mobile. Just with the two fingers, you can enlarge it right on the mobile. So kg per second is the mass, and calorific value unit is kilojoule. It's kilojoule per kg. Kilojoule per kg. Now, if you see here, kilojoule per kg and kg per second, what is happening here? Kg, kg is getting cancelled, and finally you have kilojoule per second. That is nothing but kilowatt. So, simple way, what you have to do is you have to multiply mass, okay, mass and this CV. What do you do? So, what you get here, input is nothing but mass into mass flow rate. It has to be actually m dot. When you solve numerical in on the paper, in the exam, so you have to write it is m dot, because is it mass flow rate and into CV. So mass flow rate into CV. And now you will do that calculation. Mass flow rate is 1.157. And then you have input as a CV 20,000 joule. And final value is, what is the value? 23,148.15. It is kilojoule per second. That is nothing but watt. Okay, kilowatt. And now what you have here is the output. This output you have in terms of kilowatt only. Okay, the kilojoule per second is only nothing but the kilowatt. So I can mention here again kilowatt. So you have input and you have output now. And what is the efficiency?
Output by input.
Yes, efficiency I'll write here. Efficiency dot is equal to output divided by input. Okay, so you do that calculation. Output is how much? This is the output 9000, and input is this into 100 in terms of percentage. So you get percentage efficiency is this. Okay, fine. This is your answer.
Fine. And some people have not muted themselves. Please mute yourself. There is echo, there is noise. Okay.
Shall we move further? So efficiency is 38.88%. Okay. No doubt. So what is the answer now here? Answer is 38.88%. That is the efficiency. Now again, a simple example where I expect that you will solve in a minute or 2 minutes. Steam power plant has coal consumption of 165 tons per hour. Now here it is not per day, it is per hour. 165 tons per hour. Calorific value of coal is 3500 kilo calorie per kg. Kilo calorie is not in kilo joule. You need to read units properly. Kilo calorie value is CV is 3500 kilo calorie per kg. If power generation is 250 megawatt, find overall efficiency of power plant. Use relation 1 kilocalorie is equal to 4.18 kilojoule.
Are you with me?
We will solve this numericals and very less syllabus, theoretical syllabus remained. So we will update it soon today. Note down quickly the given data. Mass of the fuel. Okay, now. Who is this? Now this kind of email ID, how can we admit? No names and nothing. Okay. Again, we'll go to. No. Okay. The numerical number third. Fine. If you see. No, this is not the numerical. Okay, I need to get another one. I'll copy here this thing so that I can call Excel file. So this is example 3.
I hope it is visible, clearly visible. And like I said, you can enlarge with fingers.
Your finger, two fingers, index fingers and thumb. Okay. So here is the fuel consumption. Coal consumption, I can say it is 65 tons per day. Calorific value is 3,500 kilocalorie per kg. Kilocalorie per kg. And power generation is, that is, output is 250 megawatt. Okay, and what we have to use, this is the relation. Okay, so what is the given data? I'll call Excel file. Okay, so I'll write given. What is the given now? Fuel consumption, mass of the fuel in terms of, what is it? 165 tons per hour. So what you do for this, you just convert this 165 into 1000. So what you do actually, 165 that you are converting tons into 1000 kg in kg. So 165 into 1000 kg per hour. So per hour is nothing but 3600 seconds. Correct? 60 into 60. So you have this 45.83. What is it? Kg per second. Okay. Mass is in this way. Okay. And what else is given? Fuel consumption. CV. Calorific value is. Can you tell me what is it? 3500 kilocalorie per kg. So how do we convert this now? How do we convert this? So 35, you have to convert it into kilojoule, right? You have to convert it into kilojoule. So 1 kilocalorie is equal to 4.18 kilojoule. So just multiply it, simple way. So what is it? Is equal to 3500 into 4.18. This is nothing but kilojoule. Is it correct? Kilojoule. Per, what is unit? Kilojoule per
kg.
Good, very good. Kilojoule per kg. So this is nothing but you get now mass, flow rate, kg per second. You get CV, kilojoule per kg. And now when you multiply mass and CV, mass, flow rate and CV, you get the input power. So I can mention here input. Input is equal to mass. Again, I'll write this formula for those who don't understand what is happening. So you get the answer here. Mass. Mass is 45.83 into this. CV, correct? So 67,000? No. It is
70,494592.
670,541.
So this value may be different if you are calculating with the calculator, because I get some all the decimals here in Excel. Okay, no issue. So what is the unit of this? It's kilojoule per second. That is nothing but kilowatt. Okay, joule per second is watt. So kilowatt. So this is the input. This is input. Now what you have is the output. And output is what? I mean, output is, yes, it is 250. 250. Megawatt. And what is 250 megawatt? 250 into 1000 kilowatt. 1000 into 1000. Yes. So what is the unit is in kilowatt? This kilojoule per second is nothing but kilowatt only. Okay. And now you get the efficiency. Can you tell me what is the efficiency now? Directly. Output divided by input. Is equal to. Output is this. Divided by input is this. Into 100. In terms of percentage. Okay. In terms of percentage, so you get 37% efficiency. 37% efficiency. Fine.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Shall we move further? Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Whether you have not understood or you understood well, in chat box, and you can type your answers also if you are getting some different answer.
Fine. So we'll move further. Can I solve it or shall I give you time as a homework? Just note down it. A steam power plant has fuel coal consumption of 16,200 kg per hour. Okay. So you got, what is it? It is kg per hour. It is the mass flow rate. Okay. You have to convert into kg per second. So you will divide here it into divide by 3600. Those seconds you are taking for division. Okay. Then a calorific value of the coal is 17,793.9 kilojoule per kg. No need to convert anything, right? So once you get a mass and here you have a CV, you can easily get the input. Now next part is interesting. If the speed of steam turbine is 1000 RPM and generated torque is 47,746.4.8293. Okay, long number. So that is nothing but torque in Newton meter. It is given Newton meter. Torque is there, Newton meter. You need to find what is the input power, output power, and efficiency.
Give me some signals so that I can move ahead. Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Have you got all the given data? mass is m dot is 16,200 kg per hour. Okay, CV is 17,793.9 kilojoule per kg. Then our RPM of turbine, that is n. N you can mention n, small n, that is 1000 RPM. And generated torque is capital T, that you can mention as a 477,464.8293 Newton meter. That is the unit. Newton meter means what? Newton meter means what? Newton meter means which unit again?
Work.
Pascal.
No. Pascal is Newton per meter square. Pascal is Newton per meter square. Newton meter means it is Newton stands for force. Meters, it is representing the distance. Force into distance is nothing but
work done.
Work done. Newton meter is nothing but joule. Joule. Work done is measured in terms of joule. And what is it? Actually, Newton meter. Okay. So this units you need to understand well. Because you can disintegrate the formulae, you can again integrate the formulae, and you can solve certain unsolved problems. Okay. Always try to focus on units and given parameters so that you can understand what is happening here in the numerical. So again, we'll go back in our sheet. Okay. Fine. So what is there is this thing I think we have solved. Okay. Yes. Here we have the numerical. It is number 4. Now, same way, fuel consumption, will not waste much time now. Control Z, Control B is here. Calorific value is this. This is nothing but Newton meter. And 1000 RPM is the speed. Okay, so I'll call immediately the Excel sheet. To have calculations, what is given? Given data is mass of the fuel. Okay, mass of the fuel was how much?
Mass of the fuel.
16,200 kg.
Yeah, 16,000 kg per hour. We'll convert this. So this is equal to 16,200 divided by 3600. You get it is. Is it correct? Yes. It is in kg per second. Fine. What we have is the CV. CV is 17,000. How much? Tell me fast.
793.9.
Okay, this is here. Okay, 9. And what's the unit of this is kilojoule per kg. And no need to convert. Fine. Okay, and now what you do? What you need to find? What else is given? It is n is the in RPM, it is 1000 RPM. Okay, RPM, 1000 RPM, revolutions per minute. 1000 RPM means 1000 revolution per minute of the shaft. Shaft rotates with 1000 RPM. And what is the torque here you have? Torque is it's a big value.
77.
It's a 477. Yeah, I'll copy, don't worry. So this is 477,464.8293. What is it? Newton meter. Good. And again, it is in Newton meter. Torque is always force into perpendicular distance. So Newton meter is the unit for the torque. Okay. Force into perpendicular distance. It is the torque. So Newton into perpendicular distance meter. Newton meter is the torque. Unit is same. Okay. No need to change it. Okay. But there is a data, something is related to input and something is related to output. Input is, now you can find input is very easy. It is very familiar to you. I'll call here input. Input is equal to
M into CV.
Yes, M into CV. So can I do it directly now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I'll do it directly. So this is M into CV. So M is this 4.5 and into CV is this 17,000 something. You get this.
Yes.
80,000, 72 something. What is it? Unit. Tell me unit. Kilojoule?
Per kg.
Per kg.
Per second. Per second.
Kg cannot be. Okay, kilojoule per second. It is the unit. Here you get unit is kilojoule per kg. So once you multiply this, kg kg get cancelled, kilojoule per second is the unit that you get. So this is nothing but input. What you get for the output? Output. If the speed of the steam turbine is 1000 RPM and generated you have been given N and you have been given T, so they are asking mechanical output actually. So chemical energy of the fuel is converted into mechanical output. Mechanical output means what? It is mechanical energy that is shown by rotation of turbine, RPM, speed. What you do? So if you don't remember it, yes.
We will convert torque into kilojoule.
Kilojoule. Then, okay. Huh.
Then N at N से हम divide multiply करेंगे revolution per minute, फिर उसको 60 से divide करेंगे second.
Correct. Very good.
Then दोनों को multiply कर देंगे, हमें kilojoule per second में output मिल जाएगा.
Correct. Very good.
Then efficiency मिल जाएगा.
Correct. Output अगर मिल गया in kilojoule per second, that is the only thing we required. We should get something in kilojoule per second or kilowatt. Okay. So this is the thing, RPM, you need to convert that RPM into RPS, I mean revolution per second. So you have to divide it into, divided by 60, okay, that you do. And Newton meter, it is already in joule, so joule per second. But we want kilojoule per second, so what you do? You have to again divide that joule per second by 1000, so that you will get kilojoule per second. Are you getting it? Very nice understanding, okay. Thank you. So this is what we required. So actually when you need to calculate the mechanical rotations, okay, mechanical rotation, you need to use a simple formula. Revolution is here happening twice pi nt is the formula. Twice here I will say pi twice into pi. Pi is 3.14, okay, twice pi n into t. Okay, n into t, n that you are dividing with the 60. Are you getting? N is dividing, you are dividing into 60. Twice pi, why you taken? Because it is a rotation. Okay, rotational. Rotational thing is here. It's not a linear RPM. It is a linear speed. It is a rotational one. So twice pi you are taking. Okay, twice pi nt. And when you take twice pi nt, what you will have, you need to divide it with. I am dividing n by 60, so 60 is there, and I am dividing this joule by 1000 so that I will get the kilojoule. So I am actually dividing 1000 into 60. Are you getting it? This is the formula. Twice pi nt divided by 60 into 1000 means 60,000. 60, why? Because you are converting RPM into RPS, revolution per second. So you need to divide n by 60 anyway. Torque is in joule, but you want kilojoule, so you are dividing that by 1000. Simple, you get the answer. Okay, you do it. Is equal to 2 pi means 3.14. Then into n is N is what? 1000 RPM. Huh? Then T torque is that big value. Okay, I have to write this value somewhere else so that I can directly get it. This is 1000. Okay. 2 into 3.14 into 1000 into this value. Okay. And what else remain? Divided by 60,000. I'll do directly 60,000. What is the unit now?
Pi has came.
Is
sir, why pi has came? Why two or twice pi into n into t?
That is what I said initially. This is not a linear speed. This is not n. N is RPM, revolutions per minute. So you cannot take that revolution meter as a meter per second directly. You got it? We want speed. Okay, you want a meter per second somehow. You want a Newton meter, that is in joule. You want that into kilojoule. So Newton meter ko aap kya kar rahe hain? Newton meter ko idhar. Newton meter ko aap kya kar rahe hain? Joule mein le rahe hain. Joule mein ho raha hai wo. So you are taking it into kilojoule. So you are dividing this by 1000. That's fine. But this is the rotary speed, not a linear speed, rotational speed. So if it is linear, then what you do, you divide it by 60. That's fine. But it is you have to convert it to linear. That's why you are taking twice pi nt. So always remember, when there is a mechanical shaft or fan is rotating, okay, blades are rotating, anything rotation. So that formula for that rotational speed, when you are converting into linear one, v is equal to twice pi n divided by 60. So I'll write this formula for you. When you want linear speed from rotational one, so this is the rotational speed given, twice pi then n divided by 60. This is the speed. I'll make it one again, changes, twice pi into n. Okay, and that whole thing is divided by 60. This is the speed that you take. This is linear speed. Now v is equal to twice pi n divided by 60. Understood? Agar aisa nahi hota to kya karna padta? Agar linear speed hai car ka, so it will be just meter per second. You need to just divide meter divided by seconds, 60 seconds. Fine. This is a rotational speed that you are converting into linear. So v is linear speed now. V is equal to twice pi nt. So that you are taking directly here. Twice pi n divided by 60, that you are taking here. And t is a torque. And then you get this value. And what is the unit of this? Kilojoule per. Okay. So efficiency is again. Tell me efficiency now.
62%.
Okay, we'll check. So output is this divided by input. Where is input? This into 100. So 62.4%. That is the efficiency you get from this problem. Okay. So we'll go back. Is it okay? Is it fine?
Yes.
Okay. So always remember, when you are calculating, when you have something rotating, so you will be calculating the linear speed from that formula, from this formula, that is this thing. V is equal to twice pi n divided by 60. So RPM, you are converting into RPS and twice pi. So linear speed will be there. Then you take linear speed into torque, then you get the output. Okay, this is the mechanical rotation for the turbine, so you get the output in this formula. Otherwise, what your friend suggested initially, that is same actually. This is same. Newton meter that has to be converted into kilojoule, and meter per second RPM that has to be converted into RPS. Same, everything is same. Fine. Now we'll go to our theoretical part.
Be relaxed. What is there is next last element element of this unit is the power absorbing devices. Earlier what we have seen is the power plant engineering, and then a power producing devices and power absorbing devices. Power producing devices are nothing but engines and boilers. Those are the power producing devices. Power absorbing devices are nothing but pump, compressor and refrigeration systems, because those are consuming electricity and then they will give some effect. Are you getting what is exactly meaning of power absorbing devices? Is this this pump, compressor, refrigerator, okay, you take refrigerator, household refrigerator or window air conditioning, all such devices will consume some electricity as an input and then they will give some effect as an output. Pump is pumping the fluid, okay, to certain level, from low level to high level, because naturally it is not possible, right? Compressor is say compressing air which is at the low pressure and supplying it to the some application end where we require high pressure air. So that is also not naturally possible. It is not possible naturally. Got it? Refrigeration, the this system will cool the space and what you say around that that space there will be high temperature, and in this space there is a low temperature. So that is also not possible naturally. So when things are not happening naturally, we have to consume some extra energy. That is nothing but electricity. And with the help of electricity, you are working on against the natural rule. And what is the natural rule? Normally, everything flows or energy flows from high end to low end, high level to low level. Water flows from high altitude to low altitude. Okay, that way. So against the natural rule, you are operating these devices. That's why it is this, those are called as a power absorbing devices. And what they are absorbing is nothing but the electricity. Okay, so we'll see one by one. In fact, for real syllabus, we have only pump and compressor. Okay, so we'll talk about it. And I'll run the slides, okay, because this is an easy topic. Pump classification. When you see pump, that is divided into two classes. One is positive displacement pump and another is a non-positive displacement pump, that is also called as a rotodynamic pump. Positive displacement pump and non-positive displacement pump, that means rotodynamic. Now what is meaning of positive displacement? Here you will have the flow in one direction, it will not flow from up in opposite direction. Okay, there will not be much loss, there will not be any losses. Okay, normally it is related to friction. Okay, but you say it is a positive displacement, and what is it? It is non-positive, that means rotodynamic. Now again we'll classify this thing into reciprocating pump and rotary pump. Okay, we have in syllabus reciprocating pump. Reciprocating pump is again divided into piston pump, where we have seen, we have learned in practicals how piston, that engine is running, reciprocating engine. There is a piston. Okay, piston moves up and down or to and fro when it is kept horizontal that way. So piston pump, plunger pump, hand pump. These are the examples of the reciprocating. Now hand pump, you might have understood, no? Hand pump. There is an example of reciprocating pump. Inside there, that cylinder, there is a piston. And when you lift the plunger or move it up and down, so there is a reciprocation of the piston. Same. The piston pump can be divided into single acting and double acting. Plunger is also divided into single acting, double acting. What is the exact meaning of single acting, double acting? We'll see next in figures. Where here, if you see second half, rotodynamic pump, here the second classification is not given. But remember, we need to learn here the centrifugal pump. We use centrifugal pump in our buildings, commercial buildings, domestic buildings. I mean, our house, what we have is the centrifugal pump. Okay, the centrifugal pump in farms, farmer is using this kind of pump, centrifugal pumps. Okay,
So what is there and how it is working, that we'll see first. So what is important here in the classification, you must learn the reciprocating pump and the rotodynamic, that means centrifugal pump, reciprocating pump and centrifugal pump. Okay, we'll move first. We'll take first centrifugal pump. Centrifugal, as name centrifugal, so it is using centrifugal force, okay, on the water to move from one side to another side, to get pressurized, okay, to get velocity, to get some energy. Okay, so that is nothing but centrifugal force is used. And you can see this arrows are nothing but the water, okay, water flow, water streams. So water is coming, this is the impeller, this course, what you can see, that is impeller. The impeller is rotating, water is going inside this section, that is called eye of the impeller, eye, eye of the impeller. And then centrifugal action is happening. So with the centrifugal force, water is getting pressurized and it is lifted to the discharge end, it is going up. So of course you cannot draw this kind of figure, right? So we'll have simplified figure. This figure you have to draw in exam. And if you see, this is a center line. This is a center line. I will not mark anything here. This is a center line. And here is the, from the center line, this is a level of water from which it is lifted. It is maybe underground tank or bore well or well itself. So there is a level of that water. Okay. So from this level, the water is lifted to center of this pump. Eye of the impeller, it is mentioned here. Eye of the impeller is here. Okay. So up to this, it is a suction head. This is called suction head. And then pipeline from that, between these two lines, the level and the center line of the pump, it is called suction pipe. This is suction pipe. From that level to discharge end or application end, that is a discharge head, HD. So you got two heads. This is HD, discharge head. This is HS, suction head. And here is the level, mean level of the pump. Now what is there inside the sump? So sump means what? There is a water storage or water reservoir for finally. So from that level, you have to lift the water. Okay. So what is there extra to the pipeline? There is a strainer. This thing is a strainer. Strainer means what? It will not allow the impurities or derbies or unwanted bodies to enter inside this suction pipe. So it will stop it. Okay. Some kind of filter, you can say. Strainer is kind of filter, but you cannot say filter because it is actually not filtering, but it is stopping the unwanted bodies, which will create some choke. I mean, that is choking the pipe. So it should not be entered here. So strainer is that. Then there is a foot wall. This is a wall, okay, which will not water to come back again. Understood? It is called foot wall. Once water is entered inside this pipe, suction pipe, it will not go back. That water will be there only, even though you switch off the motor or the pump. The motor is actually, okay, motor is connected to this shaft. This is a shaft. You can see this hash portion. This is a circle where you have the inclined lines, you can see. So this is nothing but the shaft of the pump. So this shaft of the pump is rotated by the prime mover or the motor. Behind this pump, motor is connected. Okay, the motor is taking energy from the electricity. It will run. So shaft of the motor is connected to shaft of the pump here. So because of this, this impeller is rotated. Are you getting? And that way the power consumption by the pump. This way pump is, centrifugal pump is receiving the power. Understood? So this is nothing but the pump connection. Motor connection to the pump. So when pump is rotated, impeller is rotated, you can see the rotation of the blades. This is impeller. Okay, impeller is having opposite direction to the rotation. Rotation is happening on this side. This is the rotation. You can see the arrow. You can see the arrow here. So this is the rotation of the impeller, this side. Okay, I can show again. This is the rotation. On this side, there is a rotation. This is the arrow. Okay, fine. This is the arrow. And then what we have here is the suction. Okay. And see what is the working here. We'll talk about it now. So eye of the impeller, there is a connection of the suction pipe to the eye of the impeller here, up to this. This is the eye of the impeller. Here is the connection. So impeller is rotated because of the prime mover or the motor, and there is nothing but a suction is created. This is here, suction is created. There is no water initially. So now this suction means what? Some negative pressure now. So that pressure should be such high that it should lift this water from this sump. Water, you know, the density of water is 1000 kg per meter cube. So that density water, I mean that water, it has to lift here. And that much pressure has to be created. So it is a negative pressure basically. But negative pressure should not be so high, I mean so low, that pressure, negative pressure should not be so low so that the water may evaporate directly. It may happen. So when pressure is very low and when water droplets are in contact with the low pressure, then those water droplets are directly converted into vapor. So such things will not happen because that phenomenon is called as a cavitation. That may damage the impeller blade. That may damage the impeller blade. Okay, so these are the impellers. You can see the curves. The circle is rotating. That is impeller is rotating. Now what you do? And that's why we don't want to damage this our pump. We don't want to overheat our pump. That's why we are filling this discharge head. ये जो आपको दिख रहा है discharge pipe. Okay, from this end we are actually pouring water. We are pouring water here, and we are filling the this complete suction pipe, this involute casing of the pump, and then this discharge pipe with the water. That thing is called priming. We are filling it water before starting. It is called priming. Now there is no air. Okay, so suction is not created, but there will be some pressure created which will lift this water. Okay, so there is a continuity of water now. That is called primer. Usually we have to do it. Sometimes water is already there up to this casing. The half portion of casing is already filled with the water because you just switch on the motor and switch off the motor at your home. But that doesn't mean that water is not there. Water is always there, the half portion. But let's say you start the motor after 2 months and all. So what will happen? That time water will not be there, and your motor or your pump will be just overheated, and maybe windings will be burned. So because to avoid that, you have to fill this discharge pipe casing and suction pipe with the water. That is called priming. That process is called priming. Now you start the motor. Okay, once motor started, your impellers will start rotating like this. Now check the involute casing. Here this is a less area. You see, this is a less area, and on this side, on discharge pipe side, there is a larger area. So actually the pressure gets increased. As area increases, pressure increases. Okay, area increases, pressure increases. So actually we are increasing pressure energy to boost the water. Okay, to push the water so that it will be pressurized and it will be sent to the application end. So very simple thing. Now again I will repeat what is happening. This is a suction pipe. So, and this is a discharge pipe. Suction pipe, discharge pipe, and involute is filled with the water before starting the pump. That is called priming. This process is called priming. Once you switch on the pump, impeller will rotate in this direction, and as it is pressurizing water, it is pushing the water by centrifugal action outside. There is a less area this side, there is a higher area on this side. So pressure is created. The pressure is actually low. Pressure is created means what? Pressure will be low. That low pressure is lifting this water. It is able to lift this water. Now water starts rising from the suction pipe to this casing. Again, this new water is getting pressurized, and it will be sent on the this large side area of the inodule. This high pressurized water, it is pushing the water ahead, and then so that, you know, continuously pressurized water will be lifting up and it will be sent to overhead tank or discharge some application end. So you can have this gauge, pressure gauge at this end and this end to check the what is the requirement of pressure, whether it is reached to at optimum level or not. Okay, so this is nothing but a centrifugal pump. Understood? Okay, is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Okay, this is the same pump that you use in a farm and your homes. Okay, simple one. What you need to understand, you need to do priming. Initially, you need to fill it and then you start. Okay, otherwise it will burn by overheating. And then what is happening here at the eye of the impeller is rotating in this direction. So suction is created. Suction means negative pressure, little bit negative pressure than the comparator to this pressure available at the sump. So as less pressure is there, the high pressure is here at the sump. So normally energy flows from low end to high end. So pressure, water is also able to flow from this high pressure end to low pressure end. So that's why water is getting lifted and it is coming inside this involute. Involute area on this side is less, it is high on this side. So pressure is going to increase. And this pressurized water is actually pushing ahead this water, ahead and ahead. And that's why water is getting lifted to certain high level and it will be supplied to the overhead tanks. So discharge head may be higher, suction head may be low. Okay, it will consume the electricity. That is nothing but a centrifugal pump. Now, very simple part is the reciprocating pump. In 2 to 3 minutes, I will close. You just start typing your roll numbers. Okay, in 2 to 3 minutes, we'll close. But you just see here what is there. This is a reciprocating pump. And now reciprocating pump, again, similar thing. Only part thing is that there is no impeller here. What we have is the piston and cylinder arrangement. So this is nothing but a cylinder. And here you have this piston. You can see the piston is reciprocating inside the cylinder. Now there is a sump. Sump is what? Here you have some water at certain level. So that has to be lifted somewhere. Okay. So that's why you have this suction pipe. This is suction head from this center line to the level of the sump. Then from center line of the pump to the application end, this is a delivery head. Suction head, delivery head. Okay, this is a level difference just. And here, this is actually a cylinder, a big cylinder, where you have this crank. On this side, you have a crank. So crank is connected to the motor. Crank is connected. This shaft is, this center point, this shaft is connected to motor. So as a motor is rotated, this crank will rotate like this. So crank is moving from this point to this point, that is 0 degree to 180 degree. So this point is nothing but IDC, inner dead center. This point is called IDC, inner dead center. This outmost, this is 0 degree rotation. This is 180 degree rotation when crank rotates from this end to this end. This is ODC. At 180 degree rotation, it is ODC, outer dead center. So when piston crank moves from IDC to ODC, piston also moves from IDC to ODC. So that time suction will be created. You can check now with the animation. When piston moves from IDC to ODC, that means what? When crank rotates from 0 degree to 180 degree, suction is created and water is coming inside. So that time, suction valve is kept open. Suction valve is kept open when piston moves from IDC to ODC. At next rotation, when piston crank rotates from ODC to IDC, that is next rotation is 180 degree to 360 degree angle. That time, suction valve is kept closed and discharge valve is kept open so that pressurized water is it will be blown at application end. Discharge valve is open. So there are, you can see two strokes. One is suction stroke, another is discharge stroke. So at the, when piston moves from IDC to ODC, suction is created. Water is called inside the cylinder. When that time, delivery valve will be off, close. When crank rotates from 180 degree to 0 degree or 360 degree, that means what? Piston moves from ODC to IDC. That time suction valve is kept closed, discharge valve is open. So pressurized water is sent to the discharge head or overhead tank. That is nothing but reciprocating pump. This is called positive displacement pump, because water once starts moving in one direction, it will not go back in opposite direction. Okay, so that is nothing but reciprocating pump. So this is a single acting reciprocating pump. If you concentrate here, this is single acting reciprocating pump. And what is nothing but second part is the double acting reciprocating pump. Double acting reciprocating pump. In this case, water is available at one side or left side of the piston only, and it is getting sucked here. It is suction and then this is discharge. Double acting means what? This is a piston. You see, this is a piston, and on both sides there is a water. There is a water, but at a time, at one stroke only, there is one discharge valve open. So what is happening actually? When I will show you, when this is the movement of the piston. When this is a movement of the piston, at that time, this suction valve, one, it's closed, this is open, and water starts moving from this side, discharge valve number one. When piston moves back, okay, that time from suction number one, this valve is open and water is coming in. That time discharge valve is closed. But what is open? What is open? Discharge valve is open and water is lifted to some application end. So you see cross connection. You understood? What is happening here is the double acting condition. Double acting means when piston moves towards on the left side, that time suction S1, suction valve 1 is closed, D1 is open and S2 is open. S2 is open. So again, I will tell you what is happening. Wait, it's not good idea to get pointer. Okay, when piston moves from from right side to left side, S1 is closed, D2 is closed. What is open? Discharge valve is open, one number is open, and S2 is closed. S2 is open. So water is coming from this side as piston moves up, and this side water is lifted up, pressurized, and it is lifted up. When piston moves down, moves back from on the right side, so that time suction 2 is off, discharge 2 is on, suction 1 is on, so that water is coming on this side, and D1 is also closed. So D1 and S2 is closed. So cross. So this is nothing but double acting reciprocating pump. So we'll stop here. Please try to enter your roll numbers and very less part remaining. So we'll see that tomorrow. Okay. Bye. Have a nice day. Please enter your roll numbers and leave the class, because there may be a next session at 11:30. 5 minutes remain. Yesterday I closed the lecture quite early because I thought there was confusion. I thought it is ending at 10 a.m. only. But today I covered it, okay? Those 5 to 10 minutes, okay.